CIA Director John Brennan, welcome.
Thank you, Judy.
So as we know, the CIA, other agencies working to pull together a report on Russian cyber hacking, what's said to be the Russian effort to interfere with the U.S. election. When is that report going to be finished, and will the evidence in it be incontrovertible?
Well, the report is in its final throes of production, and so the report will be shared with the president, who ordered up this comprehensive review within days. And the DNI, Jim Clapper, is the one who is leading this effort on behalf of the intelligence community. And so it's been a very, very rigorous and diligent review to make sure that we have a full appreciation of all the intelligence that's relevant. And I think that the story in there, the intelligence in there, will be exactly what the president asked for, a comprehensive and thorough review about what happened during our recent election and Russian involvement.
Will it prove beyond a shadow of a doubt that that Russian officials were trying to interfere with the U.S. election?
Well, I think as Jim Clapper and Jay Johnson said as early as September, that there was clear evidence that the Russians were interfering in the election. And so I'm not going to reveal the contents of that report because it is still under seal, and it will be provided to the president and to others as appropriate. But it will address what Russia was doing, how it was doing it, and how we know that.
I ask because, as you know, there are many doubters out there. One of your former predecessors, one of your predecessors at the CIA, Jim Woolsey, said in an interview just this morning that it wasn't just the Russians. He said there were other countries likely involved. He mentioned China, Iran. Are you convinced it was just Russia?
Well, we know that a number of countries are involved in the digital domain and doing things in terms of collecting information and exposing information. But this report focuses on what Russia specifically did in the election. And so I think that the intelligence carries the analysis and the assessments in it, and I will leave it to the president and others to then make decisions about how that report is going to be handled and what information will be shared and with whom.
Are you ruling out hacking by other countries?
There is a lot of activity that's out there, but one of the things that we want to make sure is we understand is what might some of our adversaries be doing to disrupt one of the foundational tenets of our democracy, which is our presidential election.
Well, let me, I want to continue with the doubters because Donald Trump himself has been questioning this, saying, how do you know it's the Russians? He's pointed to the fact, in fact, he's said a number of times now that the CIA has been wrong before. He keeps referring to the allegation
Iraq
that
WMD,
there were weapons,
right.
Yes, Iraq weapons of mass destruction,
right.
Which was wrong.
And in the aftermath of that, there was a total review of the review process and the analytic process and the assessments that are done within the intelligence community with a number of steps that were taken to make sure that we're going to be as accurate as possible. And so it's been light years since that Iraq WMD report has been done. And there has been tremendous, I think, further development of our analytic capabilities as well as our intelligence collection capabilities. There is no intelligence community worldwide that has the capabilities, the expertise, the analytic capability as the U.S. intelligence community. And so I would suggest to individuals who have not yet seen the report, who have not yet been briefed on it, that they wait and see what it is that the intelligence community is putting forward before they make those judgments.
And you were telling me that President-elect Trump will see this report before the public does.
The president-elect will be entitled to receiving briefings. The report itself is if the president, Obama, says that that's what should happen. But absolutely, as the incoming administration and the incoming president, he will be entitled to the full report.
Let me ask you about WikiLeaks, the organization that produced these leaks about the Democrats in the election, founded by Julian Assange. He told me in an interview last fall, he reiterated just in the last couple of days, that WikiLeaks did not get this information from the Russians or from any state actor. So how does that square with what you're saying?
Well, he's not exactly a bastion of truth and integrity. And so therefore, I wouldn't ascribe to any of these individuals were making comments that it is providing the whole unvarnished truth. Again, this report is going to include what it is that we know about what happened, what was collected, what was disclosed, and what the purpose and intent of that effort was.
Will it make clear what the connection was between the Russians and WikiLeaks, how WikiLeaks got it?
Again, I'm not going to get ahead of this report coming out. These are things that will be addressed and are addressed in the report.
The intelligence community, officials in the intelligence community have told reporters that it wasn't just the Democrats, it was the Republicans. The Republican National Committee was also hacked. Was it? And if so, why wasn't that material leaked?
Again, I'm not going to get ahead of the release of this report to the president and to others, but there is active collection that goes on in that cyber realm by a number of our adversaries and a number of countries. And so I don't think one should think that certain elements or entities are protected from those, that type of collection. But there's collection and there's also disclosure. And so what it is that we do is try to find out what people are doing, who is responsible for it, and what their intention is, and how they're seeking to use it to advantage themselves and to disadvantage U.S. national security.
Do you think the motive of the Russians was to help Donald Trump?
Again, that's one of the things that will be addressed inside of the report. I'm not going to address that in advance of its release.
And if I ask you about whether the Trump campaign was hacked, the answer would be?
I would say that's a question to ask the Trump campaign and those agencies that are responsible for domestic intelligence and Homeland Security.
And what about Trump businesses since he became a prominent candidate for president?
Again, that is something for others, not for the CIA director to address.
So I ask because people are pointing out the fact that there are buildings with Trump on them, the Trump label on them, located all over the world. Mm-hmm. Are those buildings now a target because Donald Trump is the next president?
Well, I think there are a lot of identifiers of the United States and the U.S. government, some that are very iconic. And I think the Trump name is something that is associated more and more today because he's been elected our president, that identifies with the United States government. So it's one of the things that I think those responsible for security of those facilities, as well as for their systems and networks, need to take into account. That in this day and age, where there are so many ways to damage buildings, infrastructure, systems, and networks, they need to put in place the appropriate safeguards to protect themselves from these types of attacks, whether they be kinetic attacks or cyber attacks.
Is it the CIA's or the intelligence community's fault that this happened, or is it the individual political organizations that were hacked? Is it their responsibility?
Well, I think there are so many ways to get into the digital domain right now and to collect information. And that's one of the things that I really hope that the next administration picks up on what the Obama administration did, was to try to better secure our digital environment. And it is one of the things that we as a country, I don't think, have come to terms with, just how vulnerable we are to these types of attacks from adversaries, whether it's to collect information, personal identifying information, or it's to bring down infrastructure, or to prevent our military services from carrying out their duties. So this is something that I think is going to be sort of the wave of the future in terms of what it is that we as a country need to do in order to protect ourselves, our future, our prosperity. And that environment right now still is very vulnerable to nation states, to organizations, to hacktivists, to individuals who have a talent and a capability to navigate inside of systems and networks and disable or destroy them.
But my question is, should the intelligence community have prevented this, have seen it coming and stopped it?
The intelligence community has responsibility to provide our policymakers, as well as officials with law enforcement, Homeland Security responsibilities, the best intelligence we have about what adversaries' capabilities and intents are. And that's what we do. We try to make sure they understand what types of attacks we could be seeing in the cyber realm, what they might be trying to accomplish, under what scenarios might they leverage those capabilities. A lot of countries have the ability to do damage in that cyber domain. They decide not to do it because they know that there would be steps taken against them.
My question, though, still is, was it the intelligence community's responsibility to prevent this from happening?
No, not the intelligence community's responsibility. We share responsibility with the rest of the government, But it's not just the government that has responsibility. We're talking about a digital environment that is 85% owned by the private sector, owned and operated by the private sector. So the government's ability to protect that system from those penetrations is limited. That's why there needs to be a national consensus on what the role of the government is going to be, the law enforcement community, what the FBI is supposed to be doing. We've seen these battles raging about what the Bureau is able to do with the various devices and with this unbreakable encryption. Well, we need to come to terms with this this reality that in the 21st century, these systems are going to be used to advance the human condition, but they're also going to be used by our adversaries, whether they be terrorists, proliferators, pedophiles, or others. And what are we going to allow the government to do to protect those systems?
Did the CIA, did the intelligence community underestimate Vladimir Putin?
Underestimate? No, I think we always felt as though he was somebody who had a very assertive and aggressive strain. We see what he's done in places like Crimea and Ukraine and in Syria. He tends to flex muscles, not just on himself, but also in terms of Russia's military capabilities. He plays by his own rules in terms of what it is that he does in some of these theaters of conflict. So I don't think we underestimated him. He has sought to advance Russia's interests in areas where there have been political vacuums and conflicts, but he doesn't ascribe to the same types of rules that we do. For example, in law of armed conflict, what the Russians have done in Syria in terms of some of the scorched earth policies that they have pursued that have led to devastation and thousands upon thousands of innocent deaths, that's not something that the United States would ever do in any of these military conflicts.
Did the United States, did the intelligence community miss the fact that Russia was going to get involved in Syria? That wasn't known ahead of time.
It was. Russia has had a 50, 60-year investment in Syria. They have had military bases there, military advisors and facilities. They ratcheted up the support to the Bashar Assad regime as the opposition gained strength and as the Syrian regime continued to be degraded by the opposition forces. So we could see that the Russians were not going to abandon a long-term ally. They were going to invest more in protecting that ally. There have been negotiations going on to try to get the Russians and others to understand that Bashar Assad is part of the problem. He's not part of the solution. But they decided to double down and to bring in the latest weaponry, both in terms of fixed and rotary wing aircraft, tanks, APCs, other types of things. So they have a major investment in Syria. And the opposition was as good as they were putting up a fight against the regime. They were fighting the Syrians, they were fighting the Iranians, they've been fighting Hezbollah, as well as the Russian military. So the odds were stacked against them. But the Russians decided that they were not going to allow the Free Syrian Army, the opposition, that have legitimate grievances against the Assad regime to prevail. Unfortunately, the Russians painted the entire opposition as terrorists. And that's why they undertook this very bold and, in my mind, in many respects, reckless military action to mow down so many Syrians.
But could the situation in Syria have been better by any degree had the U.S. gotten more involved?
Yeah, 2020 hindsight is, quite, it's illuminating. We're looking in the rearview mirror in terms of what could have happened based on the things that did happen. There's been an unfortunate turn of events over the last several years. When the Syrian revolution started in the Arab Spring, there was no such thing as ISIL. ISIL was al-Qaeda in Iraq, and it was just, less than 1,000 individuals. There was a wave then of developments inside of Syria and Iraq that resulted in current-day Syria. No one could have envisioned that in terms of the series of events that took place. So do we lament what has happened in Syria? Absolutely. If we had a chance to do it over again, would there have been some adjustments and changes? I can't speak for policymakers. I'm not a policymaker. But when I look back, in light of the way things evolved, I think that there could have been some adjustments to some of the policies, not just by the United States, but by other countries, in order to address this question earlier on and not allow the ISILs and the Jabhat al-Nusra, the al-Qaedas, to gain momentum and steam and taking advantage of the destruction of that country.
So not getting involved turns out to be something that's regretted.
Well, I think the way that the situation unfolded is regrettable.
Well, let me just pick up on what you said about Russia, because we now have German officials saying they believe the Russians are getting involved in European elections upcoming. Are we seeing the start of another Cold War between the U.S., the West, and Russia, with what's happening here in the cyber attacks alleged here and in Europe?
Well, I certainly hope not, and I certainly hope that looking out over the next several years, the relations between Moscow and Washington improve, because it is critically important for global stability for the United States and Russia to have a better relationship. Absolutely, and so I fully endorse that. However, we see that there still are a lot of actions that Russia is undertaking that undermine the principles of democracy in so many countries. What has happened in our recent election is not new. The Russians have engaged in trying to manipulate elections in Europe for a number of years. We see that they take advantage of corrupt politicians. They will fund the parties and groups that support their aims. And so there's active exploitation and manipulation of the political processes.
But some now have the sense that this will all improve under a President Trump, that this may have just been a feature of the Obama administration.
Oh, I don't think it was a feature of the Obama administration. I think it's more of a feature of the Putin administration in terms of what the Russians have been doing over the last 8 years, and certainly before that. This is not to say that we cannot find ways to be able to work together, the United States and Russia. Again, I think it's critically important that we do. And maybe now with the new administration, there will be opportunities to do that. I certainly hope so. But the facts are that the Russians tried to interfere in our electoral process recently and were actively involved in that. And that is something that we can't countenance because, as you point out, there are a number of countries in Europe that are going to be having elections this year, whether it be Germany, France, and others. And I must tell you, there is a level of anxiety among my European counterparts about what the Russians might have up their sleeve in order to promote their objectives in these electoral processes.
One other question about the president-elect and the intelligence community. He's been very critical, as we were discussing a few minutes ago, of parts of the intelligence community. Has the well already been poisoned before he takes office between him and the CIA, which he's been particularly critical of? What are your colleagues saying to you about this?
The professionals of the CIA are very much looking forward to having the opportunity to demonstrate their expertise, their capabilities to the incoming administration. President-elect, vice-president-elect, and others. And so at every time there's a transition, the CIA recognizes that it has a special responsibility and obligation to make sure that those who have our national security in their hands are going to be as best informed and as enlightened as possible about the complexity of world events. And so I know there's been a lot of things in the media and the press, and I've told our folks, just focus on your work and look forward to the opportunity to brief the incoming team. So nothing is soured at this point, and I really do believe that agency officers are ready and looking forward to this opportunity.
A few other important parts of the world I want to ask you about. North Korea, over the weekend, its leader Kim Jong-un said that his country is, quote, finalizing preparations for a test launch of an intercontinental ballistic missile, which one assumes would mark an advance in Korea's attempt to build a nuclear weapon capable of reaching the United States. Mm-hmm. Are the North Koreans as far along as it sounds like they are? How much should the United States the incoming president be concerned about?
I think the incoming administration needs to be very concerned about North Korea. They continue to advance their ballistic missile capability, and as Kim Jong-un said, even at the intercontinental ballistic range. They continue to develop their nuclear program in terms of having a nuclear capability that they could then marry with a ballistic missile, and that would be a threat and is a threat to regional states as well as potentially to the U.S. homeland. Obviously, the trajectory that Pyongyang has been on over the past two decades, to include the last number of years under Kim Jong-un, has not been a good path. And we, the United States, along with our partners and allies around the world, to include China, which has an extraordinary amount of influence on North Korea, we need to work together to change that trajectory so that North Korea does not pose that threat to regional stability as well as to global stability.
Your administration has, in effect, celebrated the nuclear agreement with Iran, holding off Iran's ability to have a breakout capability when it comes to nuclear weapons. Does North Korea represent a failure in that regard?
Well, North Korea has been embarked on this for the last couple of decades, it's clear. And there have been a number of steps taken to try to prevent its continued march along this path in terms of sanctions and international opprobrium and criticism and isolation of North Korea. But Kim Jong-un and his father and grandfather before him were on this path. And It's an unfortunate failure of the international community to find a way to bring North Korea to its senses so that it can focus on the health and well-being and welfare of its people who are impoverished, and for him not to be able to continue to invest in a military capability that is only leading to North Korea's continued isolation.
How close is North Korea to being able to strike the United States with a nuclear weapon? To me,
the fact that he has a ballistic missile capability, and he has said that he's going on the intercontinental side of it, and he has a nuclear capability, to me, that's too close.
And what does that mean? I mean,
It means that we cannot be, we should not feel comfortable with the continued military capabilities and the growth of those capabilities in North Korea that needs to be addressed.
Quickly, back to Iran. Has Iran been abiding by that nuclear agreement signed with the United States and other countries?
From an intelligence perspective, yes, they are adhering to the terms of the JCPOA. We continue to watch very carefully Iran's activities on the nuclear front. The IAEA has the inspection regime there. And so that JCPOA agreement provided some very important safeguards in terms of what it is that Iran has to do with monitoring mechanisms that are augmented by other capabilities.
What would it mean if the U.S. were to tear up that agreement, or at least pull out of its part of it, which is what the incoming president and the people around him have suggested they may do?
Again, looking at it from an intelligence perspective, I think that would lead to a series of very unfortunate and harmful developments in the region in terms of it could stimulate a nuclear arms race in the region. Why should Iran be able to go forward with this nuclear production? If the agreement is torn up and if there is not going to be the support and assistance that Iran has been counted on, I do not believe that they are going to adhere to the agreement. And so therefore, they're going to do some things on the nuclear front, and other regional states could do that as well. So I think this agreement, while many would say it's not perfect, and I would agree it's not perfect, but it is very good, and it's one that is going to allow us to keep tabs on Iran's nuclear program and prevent it from moving forward on a program that it was, in fact, moving forward quite well before the negotiations started.
What should President-elect Trump, once he's in office, and your successor, Congressman now Mike Pompeo, be lying awake worrying about in the months to come, more than anything else?
Well, I think it's, you know, all these things. It's trying to make sure that they understand the complexities of the various challenges that are out there. Whether you're talking about a Ukraine or Iraq or Syria or North Korea or any of the issues we deal with, cyber and terrorism, these are complex and complicated issues, and they don't lend themselves to easy and simple solutions. And also, in my experience, the past 5-8 years or so, the number of these challenges continues to go up. And so it's not just the complexities of these issues, it's the simultaneity of it. And the United States is the global superpower, remains to, so. And what they need to worry about is how are they going to ensure that they're able to monitor what's going on around the world, protect U.S. national security interests, not overcommit, and also make sure that the policy course that they stake out is one that has near-term interests in mind, but also longer-term strategic goals and objectives of the United States.
Do you believe they're up to that challenge?
I believe that any administration that comes in, I think, sometimes is taken aback by the scope, the scale, the complexity of the problems. I was part of the incoming Obama administration, and I had served in the government before. And I must tell you, once you have that responsibility, it's rather daunting. And we're going to do everything possible, the Obama administration, to ensure there's going to be a very smooth transition to the Trump administration. We benefited greatly from the terrific work that the Bush administration did in helping us to pick up those reins of responsibility. So I have confidence that this government is going to endure, that the next administration is going to pick up where the Obama administration left off, and that this country's national security is going to be assured for generations to come.
And where will John Brennan be?
I will be on the sidelines. I will be finishing up on Inauguration Day, and this is the absolute best job that I could ever imagine. And so this will be my last job in government. But I will be doing what I can to support our national security from the sidelines.
John Brennan, the director of the CIA, thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you, Judy. Thank you.